ñaña, ñaña. I'm so happy to have you. Hello and how are you? For those who don't know what we're saying.
Lilian Chinyanyay, muchísimas gracias. Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited.
We had to reschedule, but I think it worked out perfect.
Yeah, it did.
It really did, because I feel like I needed to watch your chat with Nat to really kind of know where my conversation was going to go. But before we start, I would just like to acknowledge the people's land that we're on. I am coming to everyone from the Gesta territory. And, you know, it's just been very important to me to learn about the people of the land I occupy. And I'm currently very close to the Miccosukee Nation. So I just want to give them a shout out. And you can go ahead and tell us where you're joining.
Yeah, I am in unsurrendered occupied Lenape Hoki land, aka New York City, Brooklyn.
I can't remember when exactly it was that I started following you, but I just remember feeling so much joy to see an Andina just like being proud, and especially, you know, that you're an actress. So I'm just so thankful that you're showing up and that you're doing amazing things. I really recommend everybody watch your TED Talk, because it just, so much of what I've been through was talked about. So please go ahead and introduce yourself. Tell us a little bit about you, what you're up to.
Well, thank you so much for having me. And I really appreciate your words, and also appreciate you talking about the TED Talk, because I put so much love and work into it and show so much of me that it was hidden, you know. For those who don't know me, my name is Sisa Quispe. I'm a Sutiki Sisa Quispe, Perumandakani, Quechuacani, Aymaracani. I moved to the U.S. 5 years ago, and I started with my journey as an actress, as a storyteller. Now I'm going to film school, and I'm sharing my reconnecting and reclaiming journey on the social media. And I just believe in the power of storytelling. Like, you can really change lives and inspire this world to do better. So this is basically what I do, you know, being vulnerable. And I guess, you know, showing people that they're not alone, and, you know, hoping to have community, which is so, so important in life. And this is what it makes me happy, you know. It gives me like a purpose, a huge reason to stay alive, and yeah, to fight for something, you know, for our people and for our voices. You know, I didn't like look up to somebody who looked like me, right? Like the beauty, what was to me beautiful, powerful. So I'm just hoping to, you know, inspire like little kids to see Indigenous people of people like what we are, you know, like strong, resilient, smart, amazing.
Yes. All of that, yes. I just want to say that, yes, community, or IU, is so important. I know we have different experiences growing up, because now I know a little bit more about your stories. I grew up in Miami, so there was barely any Ecuadorians where I'm from. Even Peruvians, it was like hard to find us. Whenever I met someone that was an Andino, I was like, oh, wow, we share that. But it was never like I had someone to talk to about my culture. And especially what you're saying of the beauty standards. I mean, so many of us, right? We're from South America, and yet we come here and we are made to feel like we are like less than. And yeah, it's because we're not blonde, because we're not. And then on the other hand, the Latinos, the criollos that are Europeans, you know, that's what you're seeing on Univision and all these medias. So there really is no representation for Indigenous people, no accurate and respectful representation. Mm-hmm. And I really think that's why our ancestors have called us into this work, right? Because not only are we resilient and strong, but we're very diverse. And that's something that Latinidad has really tried to erase. So I'm always just happy to connect with Indigenous people in general, because I learned so much from them and the traditions and the practices of their ancestors. So tell me a little bit about your experience with Latinidad. If you ever identified as a Latina, or how you feel about people that currently identify.
I grew up in Peru, and I didn't really see myself as Latina. We don't really use that as an identity. I knew about Latin America, that, like, this was named Latin America from Mexico all the way down to the south. But there's not like, oh, we are Latinos, we're Latino community. We will always like relate that identity with people from the Caribbean or like Colombians or like Venezuelans, but not really indigenous or like Peruvians. It wasn't until I came to the US that it was like, oh no, we are Latinos, we are like immigrants, we are outsiders, you know, we are sexy, we are a caliente, we are like hot, we're like, ooh, spice on it, you know. I am not a white girl, or like people will use this, like, I'm not any white girl, I'm a Latina, I'm spice, you know. I'm like, okay, so I believe those stereotypes, and I was like, oh yeah, I guess I am Latina, yeah, I want to be like Salma Hayek, I want to be like Sofia Vergara, I want to be like them. But then at some point I realized that I really didn't have too much in common with them. It has been a long journey, and first like seeing, oh no, I'm an indigenous Latina, and then realizing, like, the more I connected with my indigeneity, I realized that Latino is basically a label that it's basically cultural genocide, right? It's just distance yourself from who you are, and it's a way to whitewash everything, because you're literally calling yourself European, like that's what Latin means, right, where they come from. So yeah, I realized that it just didn't make sense. It's just, it doesn't, it's no, it's either indigenous or Latino. I stopped identifying as Latina last year, kind of like that, maybe 2 years ago, but I didn't really know how to explain it. Like, I didn't really know. I just knew I had that feeling that it was something wrong about it. And then last year, like, the more I learn, the more I educate myself, I was like, okay, this is not good. I am not Latina. And somebody asked me, oh, you're Latina. Like, oh, I like Latinas. I heard they clean, they do everything for their men. I'm like, first of all, I'm not Latina. Second of all, like, you're not looking for a girlfriend, you're looking for a server. Yeah. So no, you know, I don't identify as Latina anymore. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Thank you so much for sharing all of that. And I relate so much to all of that. And I just want to kind of put in a little bit of my similar experience. In your TED talk, you talk about the identity crisis. And I related to that so much, because growing up, like I said, I was disconnected from my culture. Like, my mom, she would talk about the Incas. She would say, oh yeah, you know, we come from the Incas. But also she had, and understandably so, because she fled, you know, domestic abuse, which a lot of women in our, you know, in Latin America experience. And when you start looking at that abuse, it comes from colonialism and the patriarchy. And so everything is connected. And once you really go, like, in any problem, this is what I tell people, in any problem that we have in this modern world, if you go back to the root, it's going to be colonialism and the patriarchy. But she always just had this kind of negative feeling towards home, right? It was like, we're never going to go back there. I wasn't allowed to go back until I was older. But I just didn't know anything about my culture. And I didn't think of myself as Spanish either. Like, I was just like, I don't know where I'm from. And some people would say, oh, but are you Asian? And I'd say, I don't know. I don't think so. I don't have, like, you know, they are our very distant ancestors. But I was like, no, I don't have like any Asian family. You know, unfortunately, it took a DNA test to get, you know, the DNA test had to tell me you are a Native American. At the time, that's what they were saying. And it's, you know, it didn't only say from Ecuador, but it also said Quechua from Peru. And then I have some indigenous from Anahuac from Mexico as well. So it just opened up this whole new world for me. And I was like, okay, I felt like that was the confirmation or the permission to go and do the research and to do the reconnecting. I just have to say that, you know, ever since I've connected to our ancestors' Cosmovision, it just
changed your life.
It just changed my life and everything. And like you said, for me, I started identifying as Latina because I used to be a fashion blogger, like maybe 5-6 years ago, and I was working, I was a photographer as well, so I was shooting a lot of these Latina bloggers, and I saw how it happened, right? The media and Instagram especially, they started profiting off of Latinidad, and so all the bloggers that had any, and most of the bloggers here are of Cuban descent and European Cuban descent, so, you know, they are the criollos, they are the Latinos. But mm-hmm. they kind of started that off. And I was like, okay, I'm going to identify as Latinx because it's different, mm-hmm. you know? And it's really not. Just because you change a letter, it doesn't change the intent or the meaning behind the word. Latinidad was created with the intent to erase Indigenous people.
Yes.
I just hope the more we talk about it, the more we have open conversations, and the more we can be vulnerable and say, hey, I used to identify as Latina too, but I've grown, I've learned, I've done some, you know, soul work, because a lot of this decolonizing work is really spiritual work. You know, it hit me one day that this work that we're doing now, it started 500 years ago when the colonizers came. Like, as soon as the colonizers came, our ancestors were resisting and decolonizing and trying to save our cultures. Indigenous people are so resilient and so incredible, and we are the future, right?
I'm pretty sure we are. I was just talking with a friend about it. Indigenous is the future. It is. Like, we are going back to it. Also, I'm pretty sure that if we wouldn't be labeled as Hispanic or Latinos in the census, like, we would, Indigenous people would be so much better. But that's the problem with Latinidad, right? That it distances us from our brothers and sisters from the north. And at the same time, it's like basically like minimize our like existence, right? So I'm pretty sure, yeah, we are the future.
What you just mentioned is perfect for me to plug in the book that I wanted to tell people about. This is Open Veins of Latin America, and that's exactly what this book talks about. This book talks about how, you know, brown people are the majority. Black and brown people are becoming the majority. And the government has known this. This is why they have tried so hard and why they continue to support, you know, mestizaje and Latinidad, because they know that as long as they keep us asleep and away from our real identity, that we won't revolt and we won't unite, because Black and brown people, descendants of Africa, and then the Indigenous people of Avialala, if they united, we would take over, you know?
Game over. I'm serious, because Indigenous people, we do not believe with political borders. You know, since I identify as Indigenous, I do not feel anymore like an immigrant, like, oh, wow, I'm an outsider in the U.S. No, I actually feel I have a bigger connection with the land than any other person who's not from, you know, a Tortola Island or Avialala. I feel entitled. I feel like, yeah, this is our land. Like, my ancestors, they travel up and down. Like, I'm not talking about for like 2,000 years. I'm talking about for like thousands and thousands and thousands of years. So yeah, it really changed like the way I see my whole world.
Yes, yourself and other people, right? And exactly what you said, borders created that separation between peoples, because our peoples were always connected. I mean, that's why you have proof, you know, that Maya communities had sent their stuff to Anahuac. There are people from Mexico that also have ancestry from Peru, and like vice versa, like me.
The corn is actually from Central America.
The Mayan is the, their creation story is all about corn. So they are the people of the corn.
Yeah, and the peppers, you know, the chiles from Mexico, they come from the Andes, you know, somehow it migrated, you know, and they developed like thousands of different, you know, chiles, and we developed thousands of different types of corn, you know, and potatoes and so many things. So, yeah, you know, we have been migrated like up and down.
All the time, yeah, there were no borders, mm-hmm. there were no borders. And I hope that we can go back to that soon, right? I want to keep talking about beauty standards, especially since, you know, I think you and I are people that are trying to show a different type of beauty. And to be transparent, you know, I also do carry Spanish and Portuguese blood. But I don't claim those who don't claim me. If I went to Spain, they would not claim me.
I mean, you don't look European, you know, you don't look white. Same with me. I really don't know what's my percentage. I don't know. Like, I have been treated my whole life as Indigenous, you know. Of course, I have a different experience of being Indigenous from, like, living, be born and raised in the Andes and speaking Quechua. But still, you know, I had my own different city indigenous struggles.
I've come to understand of it as like the same struggle, but of different circumstances. You know, it's the same struggle to get back home to who we are and back to indigenous ways. Because I think the reason why so many of us struggle living in this society is because it doesn't align with our souls. The way that everything has been going, especially, you know, colonialism turned into capitalism. We have been extracting from the earth for so long. And the earth is a very intelligent being. And it's like, I'm done. No more of this. And that's really why indigenous peoples are the future. Because they are the ones that hold the ancient indigenous wisdom that is going to save us. And sadly, that's one of the things that we really need to advocate for and watch for. The Amazon, and not just the Amazon, but right now, Peru had an oil spill as well. We have to say no to capitalism and no to extracting from the earth, because mm-hmm. it's just really what has gotten us to this point.
Yeah, you know, it's a constant fight. It has been like that for so long. And, you know, like the only way right now, I think, it's voting. And I mean, unfortunately, that's what it is, you know, having more indigenous people in the government, you know, with the mindset, like, right. But yeah, you know, that has to be also with the way how we see ourselves, you know, in this world. How do we perceive ourselves as humans in this world, like as superior, right? That we are better, we are like more intelligent, we are like, you know, we are here and we're in a position to save the world because we are better than the world, right? And we don't see ourselves like that. We have this extractive relationship with Mother Earth, like we take, you know, the fuels, like, and then animals, we also, you know, so it's just like, it has to do a lot with perception, like how do we really see ourselves? And I was talking about that on my TED talk, right? That it really can change our world view. Hopefully more people are going to be awakening, right? And realizing who they really are, because we have been told our whole life, we are this, we're that, we are less, we are Latinos, indigenous people are extinct, right? They told me that, like, no, the Incas are extinct. Like, they don't exist anymore. So I was like, okay, so who are the indigenous people? Like, who are those people then? I don't get it. Are they related to Inca? Wait, who am I? Like, just doesn't make sense, right? That's why it is important to question these beliefs that has been placed upon us for so long, because we believe it and then everybody else believes it and then it becomes a reality, right? But this is the moment where we really need to, like, open our eyes, you know, question everything. And the most important, like, stay in community, because it's not an easy road. Like, it is rough, you know, it can get also depressing because there's so many struggles within our communities. But, you know, it is important to stay hopeful, you know, to create some change in the future or right now, just by sharing your voice. I think just by even talking about it, you know. I know we're doing something.
Yes, yes. Oh my goodness, yes to all of that. I think for indigenous peoples, it's hard, but we can do it, because our ancestors, my goodness, they had to go through so many things and things have changed. But like you said, this is really the time that people are going to wake up. I've been following like decolonial astrology. My astrology teacher actually, yes. They are a decolonial astrologer. I will share their page with you. But
wow. I'm learning about astrology. Because you know what? And I want to share this book with you. Genesis de la Cultura Andina. It literally talks about like astrology and like how we were connected with the...
Yes. Beautiful. I love the
Chacana. And this is Pacamalki. Mm-hmm. You know, looking up. And it's about the stars.
Really? I love that. Thank you for sharing that.
You know, such a huge connection with the stars, because we believe in energy. Like, we know it affects. And I was very skeptical because I grew up, you know, in a very Christian household. Mm-hmm. And they will be like, no, we don't believe in that. It's not Christian, right? So I was like staying away from it. I recently just started to learn about like astrology, about like my sun, like my moon, like my rising. my rising, my Venus, everything. And I was like, wow, this makes so much sense. Like, that is exactly what's going on, you know?
Yes, astrology is a spiritual and indigenous practice. One of the first things I learned, and I found this randomly, and this is why I tell people, like, just kind of do a little meditation, open yourself up to spirit, and then ask, and the universe, with the help of Google or whatever search engine you want to use, will give you the things that you really need to find and look at, right? But on a random search one day, I find this, I believe she's a astronomer, she's a professor, and she's from, I think she's from Ecuador, because yeah, she was talking about the Quechua people, but she lives in Switzerland or some European country over there. Anyway, she did this whole presentation of the original people of Quito, which are the Quitucara, and this is like 30,000 years ago. They were the first astronomers of the area. So yes, our people, maybe they didn't, you know, consciously follow astrology, but they were very connected to the stars because they were the first astronomers. Astrology for me has been, and it's a tool I recommend everyone. You know, you don't have to learn everything about astrology. You don't have to memorize everything, because it is a lot, but just knowing your own stars and the math and everything, it really can tell you your entire life, and it's very predictive. So because of my astrologer, they talk a lot about the Pluto return of this country. And so that means this country, the USA, is going to be wrecked in the next few years. In 30 years, astrologers have predicted that the financial systems will be completely dismantled. Dollars won't exist. So yes, there's
a lot of happening already. So I'm like, you know, my money is like,
You're seeing that. But I think this is actually the perfect place to have this conversation, is that a lot of astrologers who are not about decolonizing or indigenizing, they have actually been pushing crypto. And so crypto is not the correct alternative to dollars, because crypto is killing our earth. Crypto uses up so much energy, and that's crypto and NFTs. But this is something that people think is going to be the next monetary system. And in reality, it will be the end of humanity, because it already, I call it the highway to hell. I know it's a lot. And I don't mean to like scare people or fear monger, because that's not what I'm about. But I think it's a good point to make, because it's what you said. We need to wake up. We need to remember our relationship to the land. And for us indigenous people of Avialala, specifically Andinos, even the medicine people, they are earth-based. Everything they do revolves around the earth and Pachamama and the relationship that you have with the land. So thankfully, because of the Quechua Nation of Peru, I have learned and reconnected so much with our ancestors, because my family, they wouldn't, you know, they don't know anything. Part of this healing process, you know, it's decolonizing, but it's incomplete if you just decolonize, because we really need to indigenize as well. That is the only thing that's going to save humanity's ability to exist on this planet, right?
Yeah, I feel like in my journey, you know, there is a point that you reach like, okay, you are learning, you're reading everything. But then it's like, you need community. Like, then it's like, I am so grateful, you know, that I have the chance to go back to Peru and have a home there. And then, you know, to meet people and, you know, to be part now of celebrations. Now, I celebrated the Inti Raymi last year in the Indigenous Valley in Cusco. And now I'm going back to celebrate the Pujliais, which is basically like the celebration of the rainy season, like reproducing. And at the same time, it's like a good way to look for a partner.
Good luck. If it's meant to be, you know.
You never know. You never know. And I feel like I needed to go, because I want to be part of it. You know, it's like, it's calling me. It's like, no, I have to go. When I went to the Inti Raymi, it was such a beautiful experience of, like, because it's a new song, right? So mm-hmm. it was like a newborn, like a new year, like a new beginning. And it was exactly what I needed. I went there and I was like, oh, okay, the Inti Raymi, that's amazing. I'm in the celebration. So I was hoping to go to Sacsayhuaman, which is like kind of like theatrical celebration. Mm-hmm. But then I was invited to an actual celebration, like within the communities. There were like different indigenous people from different parts of Peru, and sometimes they go Bolivians, they go Aymaras, you know, they go Mapuches, mm-hmm. Quichuas, and I was like so impressed because our people are still fighting, you know, to keep our customs, to keep our traditions, our culture, and you know, it is alive. And yes, and I'm like, I wanna be part of it. You know, if I can make it, I'll do it. Because at the end, what is life for? Like,
absolutely. Oh my goodness, when you said the Inti Raymi, I'm like, that's my dream.
So special.
I have, you know, read, I have seen some videos as well, but of course there's nothing like being there because, you know, you just feel that yeah. energy. I'm sure the energy is,
you know, everything is about energy. And it's so crazy because even in Sacsayhuaman, they used to celebrate the Inti Raymi in Sacsayhuaman. And, you know, we used to have like the different suyos, like we yes. have suyo, anti suyo, right? Mm-hmm. And each suyo will have their own entrance. Mm-hmm. They wouldn't use like the same entrance because every entrance carry like an energy. Mm-hmm. So they will have their own entrance, their own like clothing, you know. So it just says so much about like how important for us it is, the energy. I believe I am very intuitive, you know, like I have this like sense, I don't know, that I can feel energy. The more I learn about my ancestors and our culture, it's like, wow, everything just makes sense.
I call him my teacher, but he technically doesn't know who I am. But I've just learned so much from him, and I'm planning to go visit him. But his name is Ñaupani Puma, and he actually created this beautiful place in Ecuador called Munay Suyo. And so that's supposed to be the fifth dimension. And I will share the video with you because it's on YouTube. It's a whole chat. I learned so much from it. But he basically says that he was called by Inti. You know, he wanted to retire. He just wanted to have a family and just live a normal life. And that Inti told him, no, you have to create this place, this physical place called Munay Suyu. And that is the fifth dimension that our ancestors were creating. You know that the colonizers were looking for El Dorado.
Yeah.
El Dorado was not a real like place here on this dimension. It was another realm that our ancestors created. And so the colonizers were never going to find it because obviously they were not spiritual people. They didn't believe in all of that. But our ancestors left it kind of in the beginning stages. And now it's our turn to go back and finish that work that they started.
Wow.
It's really amazing. And it's what you said, you know, we are people of energy. We are people of Munay. Yeah. I'm on a medicine path. So, you know, for me, the connection with Pachamama is the most important thing. She is my life source. You know, she's everybody's life source. But, you know, me daily without her, I don't function, especially because of my astrology, because I'm deficient in earth. So I literally need to be outside with the land to have a good day. And it's fine. And, you know, astrology has helped me because that's how incredible astrology is. It's like looking at your needs and specifically the energies, right? Because that's what it all is. It's how can we use this tool that we have to just make it a little bit easier to deal with these huge planets that are sending energy our way with the new Stapaco path. That's all energy work. And I truly believe that decolonizing and indigenizing is also energy work. It's huge energy work. And so I am just so thankful that, you know, we get to connect because it's exactly what you said. Without community, I got to that point that you were talking about right now. In mm-hmm. December of 2020, I was angry. I was just really angry because I knew the history. I knew what the colonizers had done. I knew that we had all the information. So in my head, it was just like, how do we know all this, but we still don't do anything? Mm-hmm. You know, it was a shock, and it was a lot of rage, honestly. But that's when the work with Dr. Rocio Rosales Mesa, one of my teachers, you know, that's when she really helped me start indigenizing. And then mm-hmm. naturally, I just started also finding my other teachers and Mari Lucien and my Lakota teacher, Miranda Bennett, as well. So for me, it's like you. I grew up in a Catholic, you know, not Christian, but Catholic. And it was like, we don't talk about spirituality. My stepmom, she actually did, she initiated me into the tarot. She initiated me into energies and things like that. But she was actually studying like Wiccan things, not indigenous from, and she's very indigenous. So it's also very funny to see that. But finding the Cosmovision and reconnecting to the Cosmovision is what I think will help everybody. And that's, you know, that's reconnecting to your own ancestors' Cosmovision. Yes. Because while I think it's hard, yeah, exactly, right?
Because that's where
you're gonna find the thing that you need. Exactly.
It is enough. Yeah.
And I think a lot of people, you know, like appreciate our cultures, right? And they want to learn. And I've actually met a lot of people who are indigenous as well and follow the Quero, the New Stapaco path, but then they still found their way back to their own indigenous practices. You know, that was like a way in, but they didn't stay there. They kept going and finding the practices of their own ancestors. And so I'm just thankful that I was like led by spirit to this work, because for me, you know, I was like, I'm a photographer. I've always been all about Pachamama. That is true. I've always been like an earth guardian, even without knowing it, right? I just feel like this anxiety of like the earth, something's happening to the earth. I would tell my grandmother, I would tell everybody, actually, like this was 5-6 years ago before I was consciously colonizing, but I would tell people Miami's going to be underwater. And they'd be like, you're crazy. Like they would literally say, you're crazy. And now we have the data to back it up. You know, like everybody in Florida knows that Florida completely will be underwater in the next 20 to 30 years. And we're going to basically, everybody who lives here is going to become a climate refugee because they won't have anywhere to live here. So it's just like, when are we, you know, when are we going to wake up? But I do have
hope. Did you hear anything about Brooklyn?
Well, you know that it's the coast. It's the, yeah, so I'm sure, Manhattan, I'm sure will be gone. Even like parts of Texas, Louisiana, like it's just, it's going to be underwater. But Florida, because we're already so low, all of Florida will be wiped out. And so I think that's a really, it's a really sad thing to think about, right? But I think also if we just take a breath and we just say, okay, we have guidance though. Indigenous peoples have the answers. Indigenous peoples can communicate with our earth. So we should listen to them and really, I guess this is where I say land back, right? Because there's no other solution. The governments, they can try to help. And Indigenous people in governments can, you know, I think it's different. In the South, you know, in Latin America, I think they, Indigenous people have a little bit more power to actually make change. I don't think here Indigenous people have enough power. And you know, Deb, the Secretary of Interior, she's a great example of that. You know, she's a great person. She's doing her work. She's doing the most she can, and she's still overpowered. So I truly believe that our collective awakening is going to happen when we awaken to our own reality, right? And then we just come together in community.
We are.
Right. And it is happening. And actually 2022, the astrology supports community, you know, it supports the nourishing of community. So I'm really excited. And I'm really excited that we got to chat. I do want to talk about blood quantum, right? Because that's related to our own journeys of how we couldn't see ourselves as Indigenous women. You know,
yes.
You grew up and in the culture and I grew up, you know, further away. We still resisted accepting that we were Indigenous. And it's why? Because of blood quantum. Because the blood quantum is so ingrained in our people. For example, I'm going to use my mom. But she would say, just recently, she would say, no, we're not Indigenous because we don't belong to a tribe. We don't, you know, we live in this society. So you can't be Indigenous and live in this modern world. And it's really sad that a lot of older generations, and my mom's not that old actually, she's like 40, but this is exactly what we are trying to teach people about, right? Blood quantum, because blood quantum is what destroyed Native communities here.
Yeah.
That's what I wanted to tell you about the beauty standards as well. Now that I see Indigenous women, Native women from the North, Native women from the South, like, I feel so seen. I'm like, oh, you know, we could be cousins. Like, look at us. You know, it's like representation. And so I really am waiting for the day that we get an Indigenous channel where it's just like Indigenous creation.
You know, I really want to have like a channel of Native voices. Like,
I want to hear about you producing Vive el Quechua, because I'm like, that's yes. Beautiful. I'm so proud of you and just so thankful that people are funding it, because I started watching Vive el Quechua, I think even before. Yeah, I was watching it before I found you, and maybe that's why Instagram was like, hey, you should follow this person. It was like at the beginning of 2021 that I was really just like, I want, you know, the language. You and Nat spoke about this as well. My people speak Quechua, and so I want to learn Quechua. And then I was like, but I also feel really called to Peru, and obviously I have ancestors who are Quechua, so why not try to learn both? For the most part, they're similar. So I started looking up on YouTube how to learn Quechua, and that's when Vive el Quechua came up, and I just fell in love, and I was like, oh my God, I love her.
She's the host. She's
yes, she's amazing.
I love her so much. I'm gonna see her soon, and we are now working on the third episode of Vive el Quechua. Check out, second season is up.
Yes, everybody go check it out on YouTube, Vive el Quechua, and also follow their Instagram page.
You know, not knowing Quechua, not being fully blooded, not growing up in the Andes, all this, you know, stereotypes are the only reason they were thought were because they're trying to disappear Indigenous people. We were either displaced, or something happened to us that has to do with colonization, that we lost that connection with who we are, with our identity. And that's a result of colonization. So that has a name, is a tribalized Indigenous, right? So yeah, all of those are lies. Like, the fact that you are not born in the Andes, you're not Indigenous, then what are you? I came to the US and everybody's like, oh, cool, you're Asian. Oh, what are you? I'm like, mestiza? What is mestiza? Like, what's your race, right? That's a whole nother topic.
Yes, so, race is a human construct.
But then it's like, what are you then, right? Because Peruvians, okay, what? Like, Peruvian is a nationality. Like, at this point, anybody can be Peruvian. And I was like, well, I'm Native Peruvian, like Indigenous Peruvian. Wait, what? So that really made me question so many things. There is a reason why I don't know my Indigenous language, right? There is a reason I didn't grow up in the Andes. There is a reason my grandparents migrated when they were like 12, 14 years old from the Andes. There is a reason, you know, I didn't know I was Quechua, I was Aymara. And the answer to all of them is cultural genocide, colonization. That's why it is important to reconnect, you know, because it's like, you don't have an identity, then what are you? Are you Peruvian? What it means to be Peruvian, right? No, it's a combination of Indigenous people. Well, like, it's mostly Indigenous. Like, mostly Indigenous. What it means to be Latino? Okay, tell me what it means to be Latino without Indigenous and African culture. What is it? Right? That's why, like, I do not believe in blood quantum. I believe Indigenous is also an ethnicity. I think we are like the only ethnicity, or like the only race that are measured by their blood. I don't know any other culture, like race or ethnicity, that are measured by how much blood you have. That ideology was just created to make us less and to put power upon us and disappear us. This literally disappear us. Yeah.
I think it's proven that blood quantum, it's in 4 or 5 generations, you completely erase someone's Indigenous lineage. And that's really what happened here with the Native communities of Turtle Island. And it's really unfortunate, but it's like you said, that ideology is still around. I think that's why it's so important for people like us who are of, you know, mixed heritage. I always say, it's because I have European in me that I'm allowed to tell white people that they need to do better. We don't want to take over because of a superiority thing. we are actually saying we need to go back to ancient ways, because that is really the only right way to live in alignment with our mother. They only needed 7 years to, you know, brainwash us, and they've had 500. So it's going to take some time. To anyone that is not 100%, or anyone that is not part of a tribe or who hasn't found their tribe, I want to say that I struggled with identifying as Indigenous because of blood quantum, and it took a lot to dismantle that, but it is possible. And once you get through it, you find a lot of peace.
I will say, like, it's a process, right? So first, it's not like, oh, I'm Indigenous, and yeah, I'm Indigenous, right?
Yeah.
First is like, you have to acknowledge you are a detribalized Indigenous, and what it means, what it's behind detribalized, right? That's learning history as well, mm-hmm. and the reasons why you didn't know who you are. You know, it is important to recognize, like, there is diversity within Indigenous people. You know, I am Indigenous, but of course it's not the same, like, my grandmother, who was Indigenous, born in the Andes, spoke Quechua first, you know, and she will use coca, and she would, you know, have so many traditions, right? I was born and raised in a small city, but still, like, away from the Andes, away from my culture, right? So, of course, we're not the same, but it is important to acknowledge that there are different types of Indigenous. They're like city Indigenous, right? Urban Indigenous, right? We're still Indigenous. You are not better or less than an Indigenous person who was born and raised in their, like, reservation, or in the Andes, or, like, in the Amazon. You know, with the Latinidad community and Hispanic community, it's like, if you don't speak Spanish, no, don't worry, you're still Latino. You're still Spanish. Mm-hmm. If you were born and raised in the America, but your parents were Hispanic or Latino, you're still Latino. Oh, yeah, but when it comes to Indigenous, oh, no, you're not Indigenous at all, because you are wearing pants. And you're wearing, like, you're too pretty. You're too pretty. Your Spanish is so good. Like, you have all your teeth. Those are stereotypes.
So this one says, how do you imagine our Andean future?
You know, people who are proud of who they are, who know their history, who respect themselves and each other. Andean is also just such a brighter term. Mm-hmm. You know, the Andes goes through different countries, and right. It's not only Quechuas or Aymara. Yeah. Right? In general, for Indigenous people, definitely, especially from the South, like us, like, we were taught that we are not, you know, enough, right? Just being proud of who we are, and just taking our power back.
Yes, I really imagine a future for Indigenous peoples of all the world, that they are able to go back to their ancestors' cosmovision and lifestyle, because I feel that's really what is gonna energetically put us in a better place as a world. I was thinking before we got on the call, you kind of mentioned that too. I've always felt energies. I've always just known that this world, it's not that it was bad, but it was like, what's happening for people to take the actions that they've taken with so much hate, wars, all this stuff. I envision a future where we have relationship with the land, where that's normal. You know, I think that's really what I wish. I want it to be normal for us to be speaking to the plants, for us to be really giving the respect to the spirit of the plants. I feel the Amazon is what called me into this work, really. In 2021, I donated hundreds of dollars of my own money, you know, out of my savings to the Amazon for causes. I'm going to be creating a whole project of the Amazon, and just asking people to think about what's happening in the Amazon and the people that are taking care of it, right? I've seen the power of what just people's energy and prayers can do. And for the communities in Ecuador, the Quechua communities who have been fighting, well, all the different communities, really, because in the Amazon, they are so diverse. With the help of people, with campaigns, Amazon Frontlines, Amazon Watch, I think more people are paying attention, but I definitely still think that this is an issue that we have to keep amplifying the people in the front lines, like physical front lines. I really think that we, you know, you and I and all the people doing the decolonial indigenizing work, we're at the spiritual front lines. because this warfare now, it's not just physical, it's also spiritual. And the solution, I guess, for people, like, if you want to see that, if you want to see a united Abya-Yala, you have to go back to your ancestors' ways, right? Amplifying the knowledge of Aini. You know, for me, Aini is sacred reciprocity, and it's living with the land, having a relationship with the land. You know, Pachamama is this great being. I am a great being as well, but we are still the same. You know, I'm not superior to her, to any animal or any insect.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I just want to hear about, you know, what Aini means to you.
So I'm learning about Aini, and, you know, Aini has been around for for thousands of years.
Yes.
And I say for thousands because it has, you know, like a symbol, which is like a cross like that. Yeah, it means like unity, working together. It has been found this in so many different places in Peru and in ancient cultures. So it comes all the way, like it's very ancient. You know, I didn't really understood until I went to, you know, the Sacred Valley, and I saw, like, it's just a different, you know, relationship wise, like, it's a family, like, you really take care of each other. And it's not like you're waiting for somebody to give you back. No, you just give. And everything is just like a little family. And we all cook together. And when I say cook together, I'm talking about, like, we literally take the potatoes out of the earth. And like, and then we start to build a little, you know, a little oven with the earth. You know, it's called watia. And then we cook it together. Like we all work as teams, you know, and then we all eat together in a circle, dances. Like, it's just beautiful. It's like, wow, so different from capitalism. I mean, I live in New York City. Don't get me wrong. I love it here, especially because of diversity, but it can get really lonely because most people are like so busy, you know, trying to survive and trying to do their own thing. The Aini, it's just so important. It's family. It's a different feeling. So now that I'm going back and celebrating, I just cannot wait to go back. It's like they're my brothers and sisters. And we talk like that, you know, how Lilian, tu ñaña, like, ¿cómo estás, hermanita? Like, how are you, my sister? Right? And that's how we talk, like, mi hermanita. I think we really need that sense of, you know, connection with each other, like, not seen as competition.
It's really what you said, that we, in this colonial, capitalist, patriarchal society, it is so individualistic. It is so, well, I get mine, and as long as I'm good with me, as long as, you know, my immediate family is covered, then I'm fine.
Yes.
And it's, you know, I really hope that the energies of 2022 will push people to seek community, because, you know, I can say we can do a lot from the outside, and we're not going to expect the indigenous peoples, especially the frontline people, to give us anything back. You know, them taking care of the forest, of the biodiversity, I just want to remind everyone that without the Amazon, the whole world will just fall apart, because the Amazon benefits everybody in the planet. So it's not just like the indigenous people are taking care of that land for themselves. They really are doing a world service. And I hope that more people, especially white-bodied folk, that they learn about Aini, and that, you know, they find the ways that they can give back. And it's not about shame or guilt, but it really is about coming together and saying, okay, what can I do? Even if it's $20 to the GoFundMe, or even if it's $20 to fund Viva el Quechua or any program, you know, whatever you can do, that is fine. But as long as you are actively seeking to help, right? Because I think that's what Aini is about. It's really about, how can I help others? And just me helping them will help me. Even if it's today or tomorrow or in 5 years, it's gonna, that energy, that good energy is gonna come back to me.
Once you grow up like with that mentality, like philosophy of Aini, there is no point of you like taking all the money that you need from the world, right? There is no point. What do you need so much money for? What do you need to buy more land? What is it for? Like, there is no point for that, because it's, everything is about communities, us. Like, when I go there, it's like, you know, people dress because they need a dress and you feel like colorful. Yeah, but it's not like, oh, I'm wearing like this brand and I'm wearing this that it's from Paris and I'm wearing, no. Yeah. Or like, even like, if he's lighter skin or like he's darker skin, they treat you differently? No, not at all. You know,
I actually think Indigenous communities are very accepting of white people, and Europeans.
Accepting of everybody who wants to get to know the culture, because that's who we are. We are like people who are going to receive you with food. We want you, we want to feed you. We want to make sure you're fine. You know?
Yeah. I love what you shared with Nat yesterday with the coca and everything you shared. I'm going to just tell people to just also go watch that chat with you and Nat. Also what you shared about, you know, handshakes. Instead of handshakes, you do this beautiful ceremony, because it really is a ceremony, and Mama Kuka is there for us.
It's so beautiful, meaningful. I feel so lovely. Yeah. Like, I go and they receive me with my coquita. I'm like, oh, yeah. You know, like,
No? Yeah, it's medicine.
It is, because you share that moment together where you, like, exchange your best coca, like, your best mama coca, and then you picture lo chachas, lo mascas together. You have good thoughts while you do that.
Yeah.
It's so beautiful, so meaningful.
There's always like a spiritual why behind everything, right? People were just so connected to the land, and they are earth-based energy workers, basically. I just love that we're able to share what we know, because I feel like everybody has gathered different information. I love these conversations because they do tend to feel like circles, even though it's only two of us. It does feel like a circle, you know. Your ancestors, your guides are here with you, and so are mine. And I'm just so thankful that we were able to have this conversation. Maybe if you want to end with some intentions that you have for 2022, or any projects that you have that you want to share with the collective.
You know, I just wanted to share that community is everything. And when I say that, it's because, you know, there is a special connection within Indigenous people, and, you know, our ways of view the world, that it's just so healing. Like, it really heals the soul. We're going through like really crazy times right now, like during the pandemic, lots of changes. Putting yourself there with people who think alike is just so, so important, so important. And I feel like what it kept me sane this whole time is reconnecting with who am I, with my people, with our culture, with our customs. And nothing makes me more happy than this. It really makes me happy. It really makes me happy and gives me a purpose in my life. For next projects, well, I'm going to keep doing Native voices. Next guest is going to be Moy. He's from the Amazon. He's from the Ecuador Amazon. So we're going to talk about like the effects, rise of extraction of fossil fuels, and you know, the exploitation, the mining companies, deforestation, and how does affect to him, to his community, to Indigenous communities. I have a channel, YouTube channel, and I'm going to upload this conversation so other people can see it too, and make it available in English and Spanish. And, you know, we're still producing Viva el Quechua second season. We're working right now on episode three. So please check it out. Just let you know that there's beauty in this world, and we just need to see it. There's so much beauty on us. The more we know, the more we can love it.
Yes. Thank you so much for all of that. I am like so thankful that I come from the people of Munai. You know, like, we come from people of love, people who really understood that the way to heal the collective was through Munai, and that love for self, that love for community, that love for the land. You know, it's just like love all around. And in this journey, it's not easy, right? You know, like, we both have shared our own struggles here, and on, you know, the people I talk to, the reconnecting relatives that I speak to all the time, they struggle with this a lot. And so I do want to say that there is hope that this is a journey, right? It's not like you get from point A to point B and you're done. I think we're always going to be decolonizing. I think, you know, we can always find ways to indigenize, and essentially that will lead us to the new earth. And we definitely are stewards of the new earth. I myself, you know, I feel very called to the Amazon. I really think of myself as an earth guardian, and that's really what I'm focusing on in this year, is to go and be in community with the indigenous people to really get their story out. You know, like, I'm just going as the documentary person. Like, you know, I'm a photographer. I love taking pictures. And I think that we need to document the elders, especially. And I'm really excited. So I hope people will also check out my project. I'm calling it Kuichiruna, which is people of the rainbow, because it's just, that's what I think of us when I think of indigenous peoples, but, you know, specifically our Quechua, Inca descendants, is color. We are colorful, and the colors carry energy, and the colors are connected to different apus and different energies that work with us. So I'm really seeing how I can share some of this without sharing too much, and also, you know, amplifying my teachers, because I really just wish everyone would take classes with the Quero Nation, because they really are sharing sacred indigenous and ancient knowledge with us. For me, it has been so healing, and that's like the best advice I can give people, right? Look to your ancestors, just ask them, just connect, just sit outside. You can just pray to them, just open yourself up to them spiritually, and the rest will come. You don't even really have to try that much, but it's just being, opening your heart, right? Opening your heart, opening your mind, opening your spirit, and surrendering to the work. Thank you so much, Sisa. I enjoyed this conversation so much. I appreciate you so much, ñaña. And I'm so thankful that, you know, you're here, that we're all doing this work. I just want to end by saying, that means viva las mujeres. I'm so happy to see Native and Indigenous women loving their cultures and spreading the love with others. Thank you.
Oh, you're pleasant, Kulia and Nanya. Causachun, 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 Cusco, causachun, nuestra cultura, causachun.
Causachun, Ayala.
Yeah, Duraycuna, todos. Mm-hmm. Muchísimas gracias for having this space.
Creo que la próxima tenemos que hacer en español.
Es diferente también cuando no hablan español.
Sí, es diferente. Bueno, y para mí necesito práctica porque a mí nunca me ha gustado hablar español. So, soy súper indígena, que es la madre.
Creo que hablo bien en español.
Pero yo creo que obviamente muchas personas y relativos, ellos hablan español y nosotros estamos teniendo estas conversaciones tan importantes que ellos también tienen que ver. Entonces, nuestras relaciones que hablan español, estamos pensando en ustedes. No queremos dejarles afuera, pero para la próxima.
Tupananchiskama.
Tupananchiskama. Thank you so much. This has been a soul conversation. I'm so thankful that we were able to have it. And I'll see you for the next one.
Yes, I'll see you then.
Everyone, please check out Sisa's content, because I love her and I love everything she puts out. I'm feeling very inspired by all your reels, so I'm gonna start making some.
Oh, thank you. Inspired. Please do. Yes,
I'm gonna start using more people doing audience. It. Yeah,
we need more people doing it, I swear.
Yes, mm-hmm. Absolutely. I definitely want to thank you, like, personally for helping me love my nose now, because I, you know, I have the nose.
Yeah, same, you know.
You have the nose.
You have no idea how many times I've been told my nose will be perfect if I wouldn't have the bump.
It's not that I hated it because I thought it came from indigenous people, but it wasn't perfect, right? It wasn't that perfect European nose. And because of you specifically, I really just learned to love my nose and be so thankful that I didn't get surgery either, because I was close to also getting surgery. So we can have a whole discussion, and maybe we should on Instagram, where we could talk about beauty standards.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Andrea.
Alrighty, thank you so much, Sisa. I'll see you soon.
See you soon. Bye.
Thank you so much, everybody, for tuning in. Thank you for staying for this conversation. If you made it all the way through, leave some fire emojis. Yes, leave some fire emojis. That's what I want, fire emojis. I'm a fire sign, so.